It's June 4th, 2012, and we are in the middle of the ApocaNIX.
The elusive criminal mastermind, Neil Nix, went insane.
We final four are the only survivors of the brainwashings and have escaped with minimal damage.
Following is our attempt to discern the real Mr. Nix from the hordes of brainwashed imposters.
Alright, so thank you so much, Mr. Nix, for meeting with us today.
Alright, Mr. Nix, I'm glad to have you here today.
Oh, that's fine. I don't have any.
So, Mr. Nix,
our first question for you is, when were you born?
That's a great question. A lot of people have asked me that. I'm kind of busy thinking about my senior board project that I've been running, so I'll get back to you if you don't mind.
Okay.
Well, that really depends on who you ask. But you're asking me, so I'm in my 40s, 50s, in the 60s, somewhere in there.
Somewhere in there?
Mm-hmm, generally.
Oh, okay.
I was born pre-World War II, baby boomer, as it were. I don't want to give you the exact date, but right around that era.
All right. Tell me, Mr. Nix, far back in your history, where were you born?
Scholars maintain, and by scholars I mean my mommy, tells me I was born somewhere east of the River Styx, but west of the Ganges.
And what is your best childhood memory?
I'd rather not answer that one.
Okay.
Yep.
Well, my best childhood memory is frolicking in the flowers, running through the meadows.
Well, I never really was a child.
Enjoying life.
Do you have a bad childhood memory?
Oh, no. So I don't have one of those either.
Okay.
Worst childhood memory is when I received a spanking from my kindergarten teacher for some kind of indecent gesture that I gave to them, which really wasn't my fault.
Oh, nothing's ever your fault.
Indeed. Indeed, that's true.
Mr. Nix, where did you meet your first wife?
As part of the marriage settlement, I cannot discuss that on camera.
Well, we met, strange that you should ask that, but we met in...
I met my wife, interestingly enough, at a biker bar in Alaska.
In a particular location, and it was just... I remember it like it was yesterday.
She was a member of a different gang, but I brought her over to our side, so it was really good.
You know, it kind of... southeast of that northernmost part of that one location that we were at.
So that's where I met her. Biker bar in Alaska. Yeah.
And did your hair go gray immediately, or was it a little while after that?
Steelquist, you're flirting with a C+.
My hair was gray the second I started teaching high school children like yourself, because you just, you know, as a word, you just drive me crazy.
So, how many kids do you have?
Between four and... two and six. I think it's four. For sure we have four children. And they're all wonderful. Every one of them.
Okay.
Well, again, you know, officially there's four. But, I'm not sure. I'm pretty sure that I have four total.
I have four wonderful children at home who were educated at Blaine and look a lot like me, so they're beautiful.
Oh, there you go with numbers.
I'm
going to have to go with seis, the Portuguese six.
Good. Many languages. Okay.
Si.
And where do you get your fashion sense from?
Oh, I'm glad you asked that, because I am quite fashionable. I dress myself every morning.
Good
and
job.
So thank you. So I have no help in it, and I attribute it to my kind of, it's one of my passions.
Fashion.
Following fashion. And
what is your favorite Shakespearean play?
Well, Tartuffe obviously isn't in there, but I'd have to go with Macbeth.
Really? And what about Macbeth do you like?
The drama, the passion, the fact that nobody understands it but me.
Oh, there's something to that question. I'm not going to answer it. I am going to go on a bit of a diatribe, however. Shakespeare is pure genius. It's all gold. I purposely did not answer your question. I hope you're happy.
That's fair.
You will be graded on my answer.
Very good. Very good, sir.
I like Macbeth a lot. You know, the Thane of Cador is a family name, as you know. And those witches are really crazy, you know. I have a lot of those. You guys remind me a lot of the witches, you know, those crazy witches that see into the future.
Mm-hmm. Future, they're all naked, but
aren't. Well, your clothes, obviously.
How would you fix the economy?
Well, it certainly wouldn't be with witches. I would definitely lower the price of gasoline, and I would ensure that every member of Congress actually read books, because I know that they are not avid readers over there, and as you know, they don't aren't very organized.
Basically, it can be summed up with economics.
Mm-hmm.
I would have coal trains come to Bellingham, and definitely get rid of all electric cars.
Honestly, I think that if every student were to engage in multiple senior projects, and they first start out by volunteering, then they spend more than 20, 25 hours, maybe even 40 plus hours volunteering some more, then they make a portfolio about their volunteering experience, and then we hire people to come in and listen to the students talk about those experiences. Do you see where I'm going with this? Build local economy while at the same time building up DHS students.
That is fascinating.
So what is your general philosophy about teaching?
As a teacher, I generally like to instruct my students, and that takes various forms, sometimes teaching them. That's what I do, and I teach the students.
Well, have you ever looked at one of those pictures, and in the picture is a bunch of hidden pictures?
Yes.
That's kind of what I like to do, where I create a picture for my students, and inside of that I like to hide what they should find and understand on their own.
My general teaching philosophy is to give as much homework as I can to really good students who probably don't need the homework, because if they understood the reading and such the way that they do, they didn't need the homework, but I just like to give it to them anyway because I know that it bothers them, and certainly in an AP class, that's for sure.
So you like bothering children. What's your favorite way to antagonize students?
Favorite way to antagonize students? I usually like to put smelly boys next to girls, or things like that, anything involving Jake Holmes, something, you know, tormenting other children. Generally, making you stay up late at night doing my work.
Yeah.
Everything's about surreptitiousness. I want to be subtle. I like to go into people's rooms, get on the computer, and write an email and pretend it's from them. Oftentimes, it will be to Connie, and it will antagonize her.
There you go.
Okay, so you give us a lot of work to do in our notebooks.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Do you ever read those notebooks?
Every day.
Actually.
In fact, that's what keeps me going, is the reading. No, I don't.
Okay, that's what we thought.
Don't even.
Who here at BHS would you say is your teacher nemesis?
That's obviously Mr. Mike Kuda.
My teacher nemesis is definitely Mr. Quilkey.
Oh, that doll guy. He's like right around the corner from me. Just can't stand him.
He goes by many aliases. A number of years ago, some students of mine referred to him as one Cootie Tang, also referred to as Kootmeister. I knew him in the 80s as Mad Dog.
Have a strange history, Mr. Nix.
It's a strange world, Mrs. Steelquist.
So about art, do you know much about Matisse?
Matisse, yes, artist, for sure, absolutely an artist. Mm-hmm.
And what do you think about his interpretation of the human form?
Absolutely, some of the best human forms that perhaps an artist could form.
And what about his work with scissors?
Scissors, he had a problem with scissors. I think he ran quite often with the scissors, and that affected his, obviously, his ability to have the human forms forming with the scissors.
Favorite rock and roll band?
Favorite rock and roll band would definitely be, I would say Elvis Presley, because he was the king, much as I am the king in my classroom.
Yes.
Keep in mind, I was a developed individual in the 80s, so I've got the cream of the crop at my fingers. The group that did, how did it go? We're not going to take it. No, we are not going to take it. I believe it was Dee Snyder and Twisted Sister.
That's deep, Mr. Nix. You got me.
I'm glad to hear it, Steel Twist. A plus for you.
Who would you save from a burning building? Andrew Dahl or Jake Holmes?
Well, that's an easy answer. I would save neither of them because, really, they're not up to my level. And had they been at my level, I probably would save Andrew Dahl because he has a chance in life. But as you know, Jake is my close, and he's like my Lex Luthor, as it were. Jake likes to talk about superheroes. We all know that Aquaman is a great superhero, and that Jake is much like Lex Luthor is to Superman. I'm Superman as well. As you know, I'm a Man of Steel.
Oh, good Lord. I feel nauseous with the question. I just have to go with Darwinian theory. There's a reason they're in their predicament. I'm just going to sit on my hands.
Jake.
Really?
Yes. Andrew could clearly get out on his own. So I'm not going to worry about him. And so Jake would be my choice.
Okay. Kill him.
Well said, Mr. Nix.
Mr. Nix, what is this?
Clearly one hasn't been paying attention in your lit class. Amartya? Hubris is excessive pride, acting willfully, you know, much like that mad dog. It's a commonplace among the pubescents.
Really?
Yes.
You seem to have skimmed over the Amartya a little bit. Can you elaborate at all?
Well, if we're being entirely upfront, I found it on the inside of a gum wrapper, and I thought it was a fascinating term.
I am the real Mr. Nix.
I am the real Mr. Nix.
I am the real Mr. Nix.
I am the real Mr.